another 5 minutes, we'll actually get into the actual thing.
Okay. Well, we are looking at the natural convection heat transfer concept. So how is it different from forced convection? So as I have been teaching the same thing again and again, that whenever there is no fluid motion, whenever there is no motion of, when the velocity of the fluid is absolutely zero, then the heat transfer that takes place between the surface and the fluid is through conduction and radiation. And suppose if there is a bulk fluid motion over a surface, we will have convection, which is having two parts, forced and natural. And in the natural convection, in a Lyman's language, we are not imparting any velocity by an external agent. So essentially, whenever any particular body which is having a different surface temperature to that of environment, if it is higher, then it eventually gets cooled up, or if it is cooler, it eventually gets heated up. So they'll bring back to the steady state temperature of the environment. So this process that happens by nature, we call it as natural convection. And in this natural convection, we have an important term. We try to understand an important term, which is called the Grashof number. And in today's class, last class, we have seen the physical mechanisms of natural convection. We had tried to recap what is a buoyancy force. Let's understand about a buoyancy force. You can simply think that if the net weight and the gravity, if they both are, there will be, suppose, I'm sorry, suppose, if there is some fluid, we take in a bowl two fluids which are immiscible but of different densities. Even if you put a fluid which has lower density at the bottom and on the top of it another immiscible, they should not mix it with each other. And on the top, even if you put a heavy liquid or a liquid which is having higher density, naturally, what happens, the lower density fluid, which is at the bottom, will tend to move up. Since they are not mixing it up, slowly it will move up and the other part will come down. So that happens by nature. So that the reason behind that is basically your buoyancy force. So there is a net force which always acts in the upward direction whenever there is a density gradient. So here in this particular natural convection, we also are aided by in a gravitational field. This is true only in the gravitational field. Suppose if we have, suppose if we are taking a hot object, imagine we are taking in a space shuttle, we have atmospheric air, and if we take a particular hot surface into the air, into the atmosphere, when out of the atmosphere, and then there, if you want to see also, there will not be any convection currents. You will not be able to see any convection currents because it is in the absence of, because it has absence of gravitational field. So in a gravitational field, when there is density gradient, then it is bound to have a buoyancy force. And depending on this force, the fluids will tend to move up or down, basically because of that. So we've discussed about it, and then we also discussed about, finally we want to have what is the heat transfer, how much amount of energy in the form of heat is taken out from the surface or from the surface of the body to the ambient air. If we imagine that the surface temperature is higher than the ambient, in that case, how much amount of energy we are actually able to pull out from the body because of these convection currents. So that heat is basically defined, it is dependent on the buoyancy force. But directly buoyancy force we cannot use in the equation, since heat flux Q is dependent on the temperature of the surface and the temperature of the ambient air. So Q heat transfer rate Q dot equal to HA delta T. So it depends on the surface area and it depends on the delta T. And we also have another coefficient H. So since we are dependent on these three, we will not be able to actually put that force directly in its own form into the equation. So we need to have, we need to convert that force into a term which is equivalent to either density gradient or in the form of a measurable form. We want it to have in the form of into a form where we can actually able to measure it. So for that, we use the Buzniski approximation. So in the last slides, we have seen that we have defined a term called whole, it's already, you know, from your intermediate, from intermediate itself, your plus two itself, you'll understand, you know that, that there is a volume expansion coefficient, beta, and this beta is equal to 1 by the volume to differential with respect to T at constant pressure. We are taking it as a constant pressure. And when we substitute the actual equations in terms of density from the ideal gas equation, we will end up with minus 1 by rho by dou T at constant pressure. So this is your volume expansion coefficient. This is nothing but this volume expansion coefficient will tell you how much expansion will a fluid have for a degree temperature raise. And the higher the beta value, the higher the expansion. You could see from this figure, pressurized air, same in the other tank also, there is, which is of equal mass 1 kg, and initially it is at 120 degrees centigrade. So it is having very high beta value compared to the gas inside the, in the figure B. So in both these A and B figure piston cylinder arrangement, the air is filled with same temperature and same mass and kept at same constant pressure. But if we one is having lower beta and the other one is having higher beta, but once the temperature is increased by 1 degree centigrade, you can see that the fluid which is having actually highest beta is increased in volume higher than the other case, which is the B case. So we can see here from the figure A, it is more in the expansion of the fluid is more compared to the fluid in B. So this will tell you, the beta value will tell you, based on that value we can say that in between two fluids how much it actually expands. But how to calculate the value of beta depending on the temperature of a gas? So directly we cannot how to measure that. So we need to have one formulation for that. So if for an ideal gas we can simply substitute this into that equation, beta equation, like here. So 1 by rho by dou T equation, if you substitute in this equation, we will come up with 1 by absolute temperature scale in the scale in Kelvin. So beta is equivalent to 1 by capital T, that is 1 by Kelvin is its unit. So if you know the absolute temperature of a gas, then the inverse value will be nothing but your volume coefficient or coefficient of expansion. Okay, so now the beta value which we are actually finding from 1 by T, and it is equal to minus 1 by rho from the above equation, from here equation. So if you substitute, so the D is for a very small differential element, and if it is sufficient when delta is greater, then you can substitute that as delta rho by delta T. Suppose it, the volume element is sufficiently bigger, we can replace dou by delta. And therefore, here rho infinity, suppose rho is the density of the fluid exactly near the place where it is actually having a change in temperature because of the presence of the surface. But a distance away from the surface of the temperature, we generally have the infinite temperature. That means the at a distance which is far away from the surface, where the temperature of the surface is not felt, in that region the density still remains rho infinite. So we are designating that density as rho infinity. And similarly, the temperature, which is very close to the wall, we are keeping it as T. And that T infinity denotes the temperature of the fluid, which is sufficiently away from the surface of the body, where we don't have any influence of this the heat energy of the plate. So that is, we are actually putting T infinity. So finally, rho infinity minus rho by T infinity minus T. So what essentially we want to have is, we want to find out the difference between the density, which is far away from the surface, the fluid which is not moving, the fluid which is not having any influence of the surface temperature, which doesn't have any knowledge of the surface of the temperature of the body. So there you are having your rho infinity minus the region where the effect of the surface temperature is felt. In that area, what is its density? Rho infinity minus rho. This value we are able to calculate as rho . So rho infinity minus rho is nothing but the difference in the densities. Rho infinity for the ambient air and rho for the density of air within the proximity of the plate. Very close proximity of the surface. So the differences we are taking here, which we are able to measure by the density of the fluid into beta, which we are calculating by the absolute temperature scale into T minus T infinity. So this approach, where this assumption that we are taking, is called as Buzinesque approximation. So what he tells is, the difference in the density is nothing but the density into beta into T minus T infinity. So that we are using in the equation for measuring the buoyancy force. Instead of buoyancy force, we are converting that in terms of density difference, and this is basically measured from the measurable properties of temperature. So if we can measure this temperature, we will be able to find out that we have a flat plate which is oriented in the vertical direction. Here the scales that we have taken is, we are assuming that the axis in the upward direction as x, and the bottom direction we are taking it as negative. So the gravity, we are taking it in the negative direction. Similarly, the positive on the right hand side, normal to the right hand side, we are taking it as y axis, and the other in the left hand side, perpendicular to the surface, as the negative y direction. Now when I bring this plate, the temperature is Ts, which is greater than the ambient air temperature, and I am assuming that the air is completely in static condition. There is no velocity component in the air. So when I keep the flat plate over here, because of the temperatures, what happens is, initially the temperature starts to conduct or to transfer by means of conduction like this, and slowly the temperature of the fluid gets increased, and therefore slowly it tries to expand. After getting sufficient temperature gradient, the fluid tries to expand, and when it tries to expand, there is a net force which actually drives the flow, which is having lower density, towards upside. So when the fluid is moving up, the place which is being vacated by the hot or warm air is being replaced by the surrounding cold air. So basically we have a flow that is happening from bottom to the top, from the bottom to the top. So hello, so what's happening is we are seeing that there is a fluid motion, but this fluid motion is not very is not of very high speed. Even though we have a very high temperature difference also, we will get the density, we will get the convection currents which are an order of magnitude lesser than the natural convection cases, so forced convection cases. So always the heat transfer coefficient is lower by when compared to the forced convection by an order. That means if it is 10, then we will get around 1. If forced convection we are getting by 100, we will get by somewhere around 10. So it's always by natural. But why we want to go, even though there is a lower heat transfer coefficient, is that in a forced convection we always need a pump or a blower or a fan, some rotating parts we always want to have, and if they will always provide some vibrations, and because of that there is always needs to be maintenance. So provision that they may always, we need to look after that heat transfer process. So if anything gets failed, then we will be in trouble. The product will get damaged. But in a natural convection case, we are not providing any rotary motion or rotating motions. We are not providing any external pumps. So naturally, we don't need to look after it. Once it is set, the temperatures are fixed and the fluid temperatures are fixed, then we don't need to bother about it for longer times, how much the time may be. So in such cases, we always look for improving the heat transfer coefficient in the natural convection case. So we will go about, we'll talk about it in the next slides and the next few slides. So now there is a fluid motion in the upward direction. Since the surface temperature of the plate is higher than the ambient air, and we can see that there are velocity of the body is only up to certain region. So there is a velocity boundary layer that is actually started to grow, and beyond the boundary layer we can see that there is no velocity for the fluid. The velocity of the fluid is zero and the temperature is T infinity and the density is rho infinity in this region, which is outside the boundary layer. But inside the boundary layer we assume that the density is rho, and then we have a velocity component which is having, in the vertical direction it goes up, in the u direction there is a velocity. So what we can see is we have a condition where the surface is at the surface also we have a u equal to zero, and at the end of the boundary layer also we have a velocity zero condition. So unlike the forced convection case where we are seeing that there is a gradual increase of velocity from zero to the free stream velocity, but in this case the difference being the velocities at the end of boundary layer as well as at the surface is equivalent to zero. So there is an increase in the velocity slow in the initial state just away from the surface. We are seeing some increase in the velocity, reaches its peak, and then again it starts to reduce. So we have a peak somewhere in the middle. It's not symmetric also. It is somewhere in the middle, and then the velocity won't decrease. Suppose if someone gives in the paper that with the symmetric case, you should understand that it is not symmetric always. So the other case is the temperature profile, where we can see that it is what we can understand directly, that the temperature of the surface is higher and the surrounding air is at ambient air. So there is a gradual decrease kind of a thing. So we have a temperature profile just like just we have shown in the slides for you. So there is a temperature profile which looks like this. So this is the, up to this we have discussed in yesterday's class. Okay, so we also can have the other way also. If the surface temperature TS is less than T infinity, we can see the boundary layer going in the opposite direction like this. Sorry, the boundary layer starting in this opposite direction like this, and then the flow will be moving downwards. And we can see all these temperature profile and velocity profiles being reversed in the temperature. So the temperature will be higher this side and it will reach like this, and the velocity profile will be like this, somewhere in the middle, and then it will be cold surface. So these are the velocity and temperature profiles. Now we need to understand the equations of motion, so which is very, very important. Now, so we know that, yeah. Now here, velocity profile, yeah, it's varying. Obviously, in the boundary layer is always going on increasing, no? So the non-dimensional velocity profile may not change, but the velocity profile will, just like in the other case, it keeps on changing in the x directions. Okay? Yeah. So we are not non-dimensional, we're just drawing the velocities basically. So it keeps on changing because the range of the range where we get the maximum temperature will get reduced. And one more important question is, now if the plate is of very high height compared to the other height, suppose if the same plate, if there are two plates of same surface temperature, same dimensions, in the same dimensions in the sense in the width is same, but if one is in the x direction, one is longer than the other in the x direction. So which one do you think you have more temperature? Suppose if it is a constant heat flux condition, so you are giving heat flux to the two bodies, to the two plates, one is longer and the other one is shorter. So in what case you can see the maximum temperatures? It's nothing but in the longer case, because as the boundary layer goes on, the cooling capacity goes on decreasing. So you can see that the longer the plate, the higher the temperature at the top, not at the bottom. Okay, so now we also can look at, now we will see the important part is equations of motion and a very important non-dimensional term called the Grashof number. If you just look at the basic equations also, the equations of motion, like a continuity equation and the momentum equation. For example, in a forced convection case. In a forced convection case, what we are doing to induce motion to the fluid, we are actually giving some external energy, like by means of a fan or a pump or a blower, we are actually inducing the motion. So that means what we are doing is, initially the fluid which is at rest over the surface, we are actually pushing the air, increasing the pressure of the air over the surface, so that due to the pressure differences, we have a motion. So the forces, the external force which is actually creating the motion is nothing but the pressure force. So, and naturally there is no other forces we are considering. So according to Newton's second law of motion, F equal to ma, the acceleration, m into a, the acceleration was induced because of the force that we are actually given, the force that comes due to the pressure force, the only the pressure force. So technically, when you are talking about the blowers are like that, it's a non-technical way of explaining it. But what we are doing in a forced convection, it's because of the higher pressure we are inducing, because of that there is a motion of the fluid. Okay, so when we write the momentum equation, so we are balancing the pressure force with the acceleration in that particular thing. And what is the pressure force? Because of the pressure that we are imparting, the fluid starts to move in one direction. And at the surface, we always have friction, which is being in, which we are actually taking as a collective effect as the viscosity, the fluid layers friction as well as the surface and the fluid friction together, we are calling it as viscosity. So there is always some inertia force, which is because of the pressure. So there is a movement which is actually moving, and then there is a frictional force which is actually opposing it. So this is, there is a dynamic balance between the inertial forces created by the pressure, and then we also have a viscous force which is opposing it. So in order to understand, what we have done is basically we are balancing the pressure force and the viscosity force, which is actually creating the mass into acceleration of the fluid. All right, so that's where we have a term, non-dimensional term we have got, which is called as Reynolds number, which is defined like inertial forces to viscous forces. Similarly, when we come back to the other things like energy and the continuity equation and the momentum equation, that those three have to be solved simultaneously. That means all these three equations have to be solved once. And when you go for the right iteration, you have to solve the three equations again. Why? In the first equation, you have dou u by dou x plus dou u. So one component you will get, the other component you will calculate from the continuity equation. So in the momentum equation, in the boundary layer, we'll have x momentum equation solved. So that there you will find out the pressure forces as well as the viscous forces. Because of that, how much velocities you are getting, how much the velocity components. And in the from the u component you'll get, and v component you'll get from the conservation equation. And so we also have the energy equation where you'll also find out the temperatures. So those are three are the equations we will try to solve in a forced convection. Similarly, in a natural convection also, we have to solve the three equations. But naturally, the continuity equation and the energy equation, they will not change, because here what is essentially changing is the way you are imparting the motion to the fluid is only changing here, nothing else. There we have used the pressure force. Here we are getting the movement because of the buoyancy force. So there is a buoyancy force because of which we have we need to balance it with frictional forces. So naturally, the change that we can see in the equation is nothing but in the momentum equation, we will see the change in and the conservation equation as well as the the continuity equation as well as the energy equation, they will remain the same. They will not be any alterations in that when it compared to natural convection. So we are trying to look at how the momentum equation changes. So the Newton's second law of motion, you be careful, maybe probably I'm not on the board. So a little slow I'll go. You can see here the force, net force from the Newton's second law of motion is nothing for a differential element of this. I'm taking a small differential element within the boundary layer, and naturally the flow is moving from bottom to up. So I'm seeing the shear stresses acting on the side walls, and we have a pressure force which is acting on the element always, and there is a weight of the body which is acting in the downward direction due to gravity. So so you have a dx dy, and dz I'm taking it as 1. So dz direction I'm just assuming that to be 1. So force F equal to delta m, so small elemental mass, into acceleration value of this. Okay, so now the mass equal to, basically density is mass by unit volume. Here the unit volume is dx dy into 1. So this is the volume. So density equal to mass by volume. Therefore, mass equal to density into volume, rho into dx dy into dz or 1. We are taking it here as 1. Doesn't matter, you can take it as dz also. It will get cancelled out anyway. So you are just taking it as 1. So now delta m we have got, this first term we have got. Now the acceleration part, how do you get acceleration? Acceleration is nothing but, here you are assuming that u is a function of x comma y. So first equation we are trying to solve for x momentum. So du by dt, so u is a function of both x and y, x and y. So dou u by dou x into dx. Again, we are differentiating with respect to dt. So it is again dt, dou u by dou x into dx by dt, dou u by dou y into dy by dt. So you will be left over with dou u by dou x is basically your velocity component u. So dou u by dou t here, dou u by dou dx by dt is your velocity component in the x direction. Dy by dt is your velocity component in the v direction and the y direction, so v. So the other things are same. So your acceleration in the x direction has been changed to u into dou u by dou x plus v into dou u by dou y. So these two terms we have already got. Now we will look at what are the forces which are acting in the x direction, in the vertical direction case. So we can see that here it is acting, the shear stress in the is tau here, and on the other side it is nothing but tau plus dou t by dou y. So tau minus of tau plus dou t by dou y, it will result in minus dou t by dou y, the shear stress. So dou t by dou y into dy into dx dy. So this is the difference between these two. So we will get this particular shear stress term. And similarly, this shear stress term will help us in calculating the rotational motions of it. And then we have also have the pressure forces, which is nothing but P minus of P minus of P plus dou P by dou x. So this will give you dou P by dou x into dx dy by dy. So these two terms have come. And the third one is the weight term. So which is nothing but W equal to M into G. That I am writing it as rho into mass. Mass I am writing it as this mass. I am writing it as rho into dx dy into 1 into C. So this weight is also we have taken. So these are the forces which are acting on this differential element. And we know that, so you can see here the extra shear stress, pressure force, and the weight of the body. These are the three components which are acting. So mu into, so tau equal to tau, you know that from the Newton's law of viscosity, shear stress tau equal to mu into dou u by dou y. Mu into dou u by dou y. So it becomes mu into dou square u by dou y square. Similarly, dy dx into 1, here also dx dy into 1. So here also dx dy. So it is a common term. So I have taken it as a common. The remaining term is minus dou p by dou x, the pressure gradient in the x direction, minus rho into g. So this is your force term into its volume. So now by keeping these equations in the Newton's law, so rho, the equation will come like this. Rho into small u dou u by dou x plus v into dou u by dou y equal to mu into dou square u by dou y square minus dou p by dou x minus rho g. Minus rho g.
Sir, so won't there be a dou u by dou t term?
What?
Dou u by dou t.
Where is dou u by dou t?
In acceleration, won't that term also be there?
Where?
In acceleration. Dou u by dou x.
See,
we should have dou u by dou t.
Yeah, acceleration is dou u by dou t, du by dt. So u is a function of x and y. So it can be written as dou u by dou x into dx. Since dt is there, you are writing it in the bottom term, dt. So dx by dt is nothing but your u into dou u by dou x. First term is over. Dou u by dou y is here, and dy by dt is your v. Correct. Correct.
So are we assuming it as steady state?
Yeah, we are doing it for a steady state case.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So we are looking at for a steady state. We are not looking at, okay, you are talking about the transient term, right?
Yes.
So you are assuming that u is a function of x and y. I didn't tell you x, y, comma t.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so that's why. Right. Okay. So you got these three terms, dp by dx minus rho into g. So now, a similar equation when we apply for v also for the velocity boundary condition, when this equation becomes when we assume that equation sufficiently away from the boundary layer, as your y equation goes far away, this equation you can write it for y velocity also, and then in the far stream, in the away stream, what we can have, the flow rates, velocity will become zero, u will become zero, v will become zero. Or you can, so this is the x momentum equation. You can write this equation in the y direction also. So now the equation will become rho u into dou v by dou x plus v into dou v by dou y equal to mu into dou square v by dou y square minus dou p by dou y, since the density gradient is not there, minus rho g, because the density will act in the x direction and the y direction it will not have any effect, so this still will be knocked out. So that will be your y momentum equation if you write the same equation in terms of y. So when you compare with u, the v velocity component will be pretty lower, so you can neglect the dou v by dou y term. So this term will be gone, this term will be gone, it's almost equal to zero. So you will get an equation dou p by dou y minus rho g y you will get. if at all, if you keep that. So dou p by dou y is equivalent to basically your pressure. Sorry, this term is also becomes zero. So dou p by dou y equal to zero. So that means the pressure in the horizontal direction will not vary. It remains constant. So that is not normally when you are seeing in a fluid. So it only varies in the pressure varies only in the vertical direction. So in the x direction here. Now, far off case. Suppose if your x tends towards delta, that is boundary layer thickness. So that is in this particular zone. When you go into this particular zone, what happens to this equation? This complete equation here, the velocity components u and v becomes zero in this particular zone, away from the boundary layer, outside the boundary layer. Outside the boundary layer, we don't have any velocities. So that's a quiescent here. So u equal to zero and v equal in this zero and x is greater than delta t. There u will equal to zero. So now what happens if you put u equal to zero in this equation? This will be left over like dou p by dou x equal to minus rho into g. But since you are taking x to be greater than delta, there the pressure is rho infinity z. Okay, so dou p infinity equal to dou x. So from the y momentum equation, we will get dou p by dou y equal to zero. That means the pressure in the layer in this direction, the pressure here will be equal to the pressure here. The pressure here is p infinity, and the pressure inside is also equal to p. So it will be equal in the y direction. So similarly, that is one thing. So p equal to p infinity, dou p infinity equal to rho into rho. Your density will become far off the stream. That means away from the boundary layer. Here your density will be rho infinity. So you can write from this equation when we extend your x away from the, when you write this equation in the region away from the boundary layer, you get an equation dou p infinity by dou x equal to rho infinity g. So thus I am keeping it here, dou p by dou x is there, I am keeping it as dou p infinity by dou x, since p of x is equivalent to at a particular location in the, and that means what I am saying is for an x in the y direction, the p of x is equivalent to p infinity. That is what I said. In this direction, the pressures will change, but for a location, it will not change. So now, dou p infinity by dou x equal to minus rho infinity z. So in this dou p by dou x term, I can, that becomes p can be equivalent to p infinity. So dou p infinity by dou x, I'm keeping it as minus rho infinity z. That will give you rho into the same term, mu the same term, here rho infinity z. So that will be giving you rho infinity minus rho into g. So this is the body force term. This is the force which is acting on the whole body. So this is external body force term. We also have the surface forces which are acting on the body, pressure and the shear stresses. And this term is basically which is acting on the volume of the body, whole volume of the body. Okay, so now rho infinity minus rho, we have already calculated from the Bosinski approximation as rho into beta into t minus t infinity. As I told you, we are calculating the density difference from the density of the fluid within the boundary layer to the density of the fluid outside the boundary layer. The difference we can calculate by means of a property of the fluid which is called as beta, and the temperature difference and its density within the boundary layer. So now this is called the Bosinski approximation. Here we are trying to find out the density difference in terms of temperature difference as well as a function or property of the fluid. based on temperature. So this property is also depend on temperature, beta equal to 1 by T. So everything is dependent on temperature, so which are all measurable. So we can measure them and put it in this equation. So instead of this equation, I'm keeping rho b T in T minus T infinity in this particular term. So the final equation will be u into dou u by dou x plus v into dou u by dou y. This is the experimental equation. U, since rho is there everywhere, this rho will get gone. This mu by rho it will become. So here is one rho is there. I'm keeping this rho b T minus T infinity in this equation into g. In this term, I'm keeping this rho beta T minus T infinity. So dividing everywhere by rho, rho rho will get cancelled over here. So u dou u by dou x plus v dou u by dou y. This is equal to mu by rho, that will be nothing but kinematic viscosity, dou square u by dou y square plus, you can see here, there is a g here, g is there, beta is there, and T minus T infinity. So this is the equation that governs the boundary layer due to the effect of buoyancy. So what it is having, the experiment of equation is u dou u by dou x plus v dou u by dou y plus mu into dou square u by dou y square plus gb t minus ty. This is x momentum, and your y momentum is dou p by dou y equal to zero. There is no velocity, there is no pressure variation in the y direction. That is what the y momentum is. The continuity equation remains the same, the temperature equation remains the same. But one more important thing is here you can see there is a temperature here in this equation, unlike the forced convection case. So here all the equations should be simultaneously solved. Once you get the energy equation, that has to go into this equation to find out the velocity, and one velocity component, after you find out, you have to put it into the continuity equation to get the v velocity component. Again you have to do the same thing. So simultaneously you have to solve these three equations. So that is basically you are doing from the governing equations of motion. These are the governing equations of motion. So the complete set of conservation equations are given here. This is the continuity equation, this is the momentum equation, and this is the energy equation. So depending on the boundary conditions, we will solve these equations. So do we have any analytical solutions for this kind of a problem? Yes, there are three equations which needs to be solved. But as we have seen in the forced convection case, by choosing a similarity variable eta, which is a mathematical jugglery of terms, which is an intelligent way of doing that, by doing that we can reduce these three equations to two ordinary differential equations which are in the form of non-linear, and we have a solution for that. So we can also solve these equations and get a solution in the integral way, integral solution way, integral form of solutions. Also we can have solution for this particular thing. So there is, for a vertical plate, there is an analytical solution which at this point of time is not important. At the undergrad level it may not be is not required. So I'm skipping that. If those who are interested, they can look at any textbook. They'll give you the similarity solution for this natural convection vertical flat plate problem. So now, as I told you, there is a balance in this flow between the buoyancy force to the viscous force. So we need to have one non-dimensional number which actually governs, or which actually tells you when the flow converts from laminar to turbulent. There is a variation in the flow. So which force, when it dominates, that will be told by a non-dimensional numbers. So for getting this, for defining this Grashof number, whose importance comes in, it acts in the same way as the Reynolds number in forced convection. How the Reynolds number helps us to demarcate the laminar to turbulent transition. Similarly, Grashof number helps you in natural convection to understand when the flow transmits from laminar to turbulent. So for that, what we are doing is I'm non-dimensionalizing the terms. So I'm taking the x star which is nothing but the x by lc. Lc is the characteristic length, which may be the length of the plate. So any x by lc I am normalizing, and similarly y star is y by lc. Similarly, u star is equal to u by v, which is the average velocity and some arbitrary velocity. And T star, I am defining it as T minus T infinity. T infinity is the ambient air temperature away from the boundary layer. And Ts is the surface temperature. So I am defining the coordinates are like this. X star, Y star, U star, V star and T star. And then once I substitute all these terms into the momentum equation, into this particular equation, we will be getting a term, extra term like this. From the equations. So here there is a non-dimensional formulation we are seeing, which is nothing but z beta delta t l cube by nu square. This particular term we call it as the Grashof number. In the suffix we can see it as l, because we are dealing with a vertical plate with a characteristic length l. So just to showcase that, we have put l here. So g reflects the gravitational acceleration, beta is the coefficient of volume expansion, which is nothing but 1 by T, absolute temperature scale, and then Ts is the temperature of the surface, T infinity temperature of the fluid, sufficiently far from the surface, almost, we'll assume that it's almost outside the boundary layer of boundary layer, and then LC characteristic length of the geometry, and nu is the kinematic viscosity. And how do you define the Grashof? It's a very, very important, this Grashof number. Many exams they will ask this about this Grashof number. What is Grashof number? Or non-dimensional numbers, they will always ask this. So you can, if you remember natural convection as a buoyancy force, it's nothing but the buoyancy force to the frictional forces or viscous forces. It is nothing but the ratio of buoyancy force to the viscous force, and represents the natural convection effects in the momentum equation. It helps you to give a balance between these two forces in the momentum equation. So what is the main criteria? Why it is very, very useful is it provides the main criteria for determining whether the fluid flow in a natural convection scenario is a laminar or turbulent. For vertical plates, the Grashof number, critical Grashof number is observed to be about 10 power 9. So beyond 10 power 9, we assume that it to be turbulent, and inside it we are taking it as laminar. So this natural convection, whatever we are seeing the external plate, we can assume that it is all external. There is no bounding for the external ambient air. So it can flow on its own. We are not bounding, or we are not controlling the amount of flow that is happening over the surface. So we can say that we are just dealing, right now we are dealing with external flows. So when a surface is subjected to external flow, the problem involves both natural and forced convection. So other important term why we need to use this. So it's not that always that the temperature of the surface is pretty high compared to the environment, and we are using a fan which is having a lower velocity. Suppose it's a very small velocity we are able to pump through the fan or blower. And then the temperature gradients are so high. So there are certain conditions where the flow will only not aided by the external pressure force, but it also gets aided by the buoyancy forces. So the buoyancy force and the external forces and the pressure force, they both are comparable. There will be certain cases where when the external velocities are very small, when the external pressure forces are very small, the condition arises that there will be both the heat transfer will take place by the combined effect of both forced as well as free convection. So now for a particular surface and ambient air configuration, for an external flow configuration, how do you say that when the natural convection is dominant to forced convection, or they both are comparable, or the forced convection is dominant than the natural convection, and we can forget about the natural convection? There is always the radiation part. I am not saying that, but only in the natural convection, these two will add, combined to the conduction as well as radiation. Okay. So in such a cases, how do you differentiate? We need to have a constraint, or we need to have a benchmark value, so that from that you will be able to find out whether the forced convection can be neglected, or forced convection has also to be taken care into account, or the natural convection can be neglected, or natural convection can be taken into account. So it gives an important number, important criteria called as Gleshoff by Reynolds square. So you know the velocity and you know the Gleshoff number. For a given configuration, external flow configuration with flow velocity imparted by the fluid, the temperatures and all, you know. So based on that, you'll find out the Gleshoff number, you'll find out the Reynolds number. And Gleshoff by Reynolds square number, when the value of Gleshoff by Reynolds square, which it's also called as the Richardson number, RI. You can write it, I have not mentioned this. It's nothing but the Richardson number. The Richardson number, when it is greater than 1, it's absolutely greater than 1, suppose 2, 3, 4, 10 and all, then your free convection effects are very, very higher. Okay, so your Gleshoff number is greater than 2 times the natural, forced convection. So that means your free convection effects are, free convection effects are negligible if Gleshoff by Reynolds square is very much greater than 1. So natural convection you can neglect when this value is very much greater than 1. And I have written the same thing. So it's forced convection effects. And naturally, natural convections are negligible. This is forced convection, not free convection. Forced convection effects are negligible if Gleshoff by Reynolds number square is very much greater than 1, and natural convection effects are negligible if Gleshoff by Reynolds square value is very, very much less than 1. So in this case, where the Richardson number is from in between 0 to 1, we will say that the natural convections become very, very important. And for the forced convection, it has to be very much greater than 1. And there is a case where the free convection and the forced convection are equal. So that happens when they both Gleshoff by Reynolds square, when Gleshoff by Reynolds square value is approximately equal to 1. For example, 0.9, 1.1, 1.2. In that cases also, we will consider that this is a combined natural as well as forced convection. We will not say that exactly 1, we will say that close to 1. We need to consider, we cannot neglect any of these effects. Only forced we cannot take, or only natural we have to take. We have to take both the effects, and calculate the heat transfer coefficient. Suppose if we neglect, your experimental value will be pretty higher than your analytical value. So these are the two criteria where the Gleshoff number helps you. One is to determine whether the flow is in a natural convection is laminar or turbulent. The second, in a forced convection case, whether the natural convection needs to be calculated or not by using a Gleshoff by Reynolds square value, that is your Richardson number. So similarly, you can see here, this is the natural convection case. Here I think when I'm copying, I've done some mistake here. So in this values, you can check the figure. This will give you the correct image. So the natural convection is more dominant when Gleshoff by Reynolds square value is very much greater than 1. That means its value is 1 above 1. The Richardson number value is pretty higher than 1. Then we say that only natural convection values are important and not forced convection values. We can forget about the forced convection values. Whereas, if the Gleshoff by Reynolds square number value is pretty much less than 1, that is from 0 to 1, you can forget about the natural convection and you need to consider only the forced convection case. So even though there is a natural, you can safely forget. So you need to find out the Richardson number for a given configuration, find out the value and say that it is in between 0 to 1, so I am considering only forced convection. Or in the other case, if the value is some 5 or 6, then we can say that it is only natural convection. We need not take the effect of forced convection into picture. And then the third case, which is called the mixed convection case, where You can see that it is almost equivalent one, where the flow, forced convection as well as the natural convection, forced and natural convection, both needs to be taken into account. So this is the mixed convection case. So in often in your some of the cases you can see that in some of the research papers you can see that there is a mixed convection regime where the forced as well as free convection effects will be studied. So this is up to the physics part. So understanding the physics, now the what is buoyancy force, what is Grashof number, how the temperature and velocity profiles will vary, how the governing equations will look like. So all this we have seen so far. The next case is, now when we apply these natural convection cases, what are the equations of, and how do we calculate the Nusselt number? As I, even though we understood the physics pretty well, finding the analytical solutions for the natural convection case is not so easy because of the difficulties or because of the complexities in the fluid flow. So whatever the analytical solutions that are available, they are only for very, very regular surfaces. But whenever that we have a different surface, I mean irregular surfaces or complex surfaces, we don't have any analytical solutions. So therefore, we always depend upon the experimental values for this. So I've given this natural convection heat transfer on a surface. It depends on the, number one, geometry of the surface, how the geometry is there. It's a regular flat surface or it has so much of curvatures and all. Second, its orientation, whether it is in vertical position, horizontal position, inclined position, how the variation of temperature is happening on the surface, whether it is a constant temperature bed or the temperature is kept on varying, and what are the properties like beta, what is the thermophysical property of the fluid. So it all depends on all of these properties. So with the exceptions of some simplest cases, mostly we will take the heat transfer relations or we have whatever we are having are based on extensive experimental studies we have. So coming to the Nusselt number, as we know, Nusselt number we will calculate the non-dimensional heat transfer coefficient. Initially, any experimentalist will give you the values in the Nusselt number, in the form of Nusselt numbers, which is equivalent to HLC by K. Here the LC is so did anyone of you has a doubt, sir, what happens to the temperature profile as well as whether we do have any variations in the thickness in the temperature boundary layer and hydrodynamic boundary layer? In this case, we don't have, even for the slightest Prandtl number or the biggest Prandtl number, doesn't matter. We always have the boundary layers of fluid as well as temperature. They both are always same. So we don't have two different boundary layers. We consider to be one. So the constant C and N depend on the geometry of the surface and the flow region. So on what factors this C and this N will depend? They will depend on the geometry of the surface, how the geometry of the surface is. There is a cylinder or a flat plate or a sphere, and the flow region, is this laminar or turbulent. Based on that, your C value and N value will get changed. So here you can see in the right hand side, Nusselt number is the non-dimensional form of coefficient. Capped constant coefficient, constant exponent, and this is your Rayleigh number. So the value of n, as I said, the constant exponent value will change based on the flow regime. So if it is in the laminar flow, the same value will have 1/4, and if it is a turbulent flow, the value will be 1/3. And when we want to calculate the Grashof number, g beta delta t l cube by nu square, there the beta we need to calculate and nu we need to calculate and Prandtl we need to calculate. This Prandtl and this nu, these are the terms which we need to get from the properties of the fluid which is actually flowing. So these two values we will get from the average temperature, film temperature, which we have seen in the forced convection, which is calculated by means of Ts plus T infinity by 2. So therefore, Q convection, you'll get it from HAS TS minus T infinity, as we have seen in the same case like forced convection. So Nusselt number values will be of this format. So all these correlations have been put in one simple table or column. Again, I have not checked whether all these formulas are available in your data book or slightly modified in your data book, but generally they're all the same except few changes maybe probably. You will see when we talk about some problems, when you solve some problems, if you find difficulties, we will look into it. But I'll make sure that I'll talk with Raju sir, and we will make sure that whatever the formulas which are available in the data book, based on that only we will give you the problems. So don't worry about it. So here, come to the first configuration. Look at the first configuration. It's a vertical plate which is having a length L and its temperature is TS. The characteristic length is, we have taken it to be capital L, and they have given you two values, 10 power 4 to 10 power 9 laminar flow, 10 power 10 to 10 power 13 turbulent flow. So the correlations we generally use C, which is 0.59, Rayleigh number N 1 by 4. For laminar flow, we are taking it this way. And the another correlation that we use for a vertical plate, when the flow regime is turbulent, is Nu 0.1 Rayleigh number 1 by 3. So given a problem, first find out the Rayleigh, first given a problem in natural convection case, first if the velocities are not given, then it is a natural convection case. So first find out the Rayleigh number. From the Rayleigh number, first find out the Grashof number. From the Grashof number, you will come to know whether the flow is laminar or turbulent. Look at the configuration, whether it's vertical. If it is vertical, if it is laminar, to find out the heat transfer, you can directly go to these two equations. And then we have another complex but very accurate expression is there, which is given in the 9.21 equation here. In the 9.2 equation, this little computational computations are required, but compared to these two, this expression is supposed to be more accurate. So most of the people use this expression to compare the vertical plate configuration. All right, so when it comes to vertical plate, again we have one more issue. That what is the temperature condition for that? So what is the temperature condition you are giving? What is the heating condition, that your boundary condition that you are giving for the plate? Suppose if you are giving a constant temperature boundary condition, or you are giving a constant heat flux boundary condition, which one you are giving? Based on that, again your equations will keep on changing. So for a vertical flat plate, the characteristic length, simply what we can do is for a vertical, for a constant temperature case, this is given for a constant temperature case. This equation number 9.19, 9.20, 9.21, these equations, whatever we are given here in the first row, they are for a constant temperature boundary condition. So everywhere the temperature is taken to be TS. So what if the boundary condition is changed to constant heat flux boundary condition? Suppose if you convert that into constant heat flux, suppose you are giving a constant heat flux case, then how it will change, or how do you want to calculate? So in that case, what happens if you are giving heat transfer by means of some resistance heater and all to the surface, then what happens is, you know that you are giving a constant heat flux, but the temperature over the surface, it will not be uniform. So in such a case, what we do is, the ideal case, when they have done extensive studies and all, they found out that you can still use for a constant heat flux boundary condition the same equations which you use for constant temperature, provided you take the surface temperature at the middle of the plate. So you can see here, TL by 2 is, if this length is L and exactly at the center, for a constant heat Q, for a given Q dot to the plate, there is a variation in the temperatures all through the length of it. So you need to find out whatever the temperature at the middle to be your surface temperature, and then you can use these equations. Your TS becomes the temperature at T at L by 2, at the half of this length. So if you can take that temperature, then you can directly go and use the constant temperature equation for a constant heat flux boundary condition also. I think you got it. Next one is, what if we have a vertical cylinder? Suppose we right now we have a vertical plate. Suppose if we want to have a vertical cylinder, in such a case, how can we go about it? So the same vertical plate configuration we can use for a vertical cylinder also, provided the diameter is sufficiently bigger. So how do you ensure the diameter is sufficiently bigger, or it's almost equivalent to the plate? For that, they have given a criteria. If the diameter of the vertical cylinder is greater than this particular value, 35 L by Grashof number whole power 1 by 4, in this particular case, if this constraint gets satisfied, then we can use, for a vertical cylinder also, we can use the same equation what you are using for vertical plate. So it's a simple thing. Now you need to understand that a simple thing is, we have three equations for a vertical plate, which we can use for a constant temperature, for a constant heat flux, and for a vertical cylinder case. All these three cases, you can use this value, right? So now, coming to the inclined plate case.
Excuse me, sir?
Yeah, Ganesh, tell me.
Yes, actually, it's at least 615, sir.
Should we stop here? Yeah, if you feel if it is enough. Okay, so shall we stop here? Okay, so when can have this class, continuation of this? I think one more class we will be done tomorrow.
And maybe even some questions we can do that time.
No. I'm not clear. I mean, too many people are talking. Just mute everyone and you please let me know. One by one, we will go. Third equation. That's a different way. They have incorporated all the values and they cannot give the expression in the above two ways. So they have changed it in another way. So likewise, Prandtl number value is not only just to discriminate between the thicknesses of the boundary layers. It does find out what is the value. So alpha value, mu value, those are all will come into the equations. So to make it look similar to the forced convection equation, or to make it uniform, they have used that, formulated that equation like that.
Okay. So that means there is no significance of Prandtl number value here.
Now, in here, the values it helps in the calculation of that, but that will not change any physics of it. Physics wise, we cannot see anything. We cannot get anything out of it. Or I'll make it clear. Let me understand properly this question and I'll answer this question properly. Okay. Rather than my own view, let me check and properly give you answer. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Number is there. When we have the same thickness in the boundary layers, why do we need to have a Prandtl number, right? As I said, according to my knowledge, the Prandtl number is it is generally used not only to discriminate between the two. It is a value which tells you between momentum and thermal diffusivity. So that doesn't mean that it doesn't have only one purpose. So it can be. Any more?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Abhishek.
Sir, sir, you told that rate of heat conduction in convection is a greater for a rough surface, for a smooth surface. In case of this rough surface, surface area will be more, no?
Can you repeat? It's not clear, your question.
That you told that heat transfer will be maximum for a smooth surface. In case of rough surface?
No, heat transfer will not be maximum for a smooth surface. It will be generally for a rough surface because your boundary layers goes on short. No, I didn't talk about the rough and the smooth surfaces.
No, sir, previous class you told I think.
That, so, but generally rough surfaces will have more higher heat transfer because it always tends to block the boundary layer because of the rough surfaces. So what happens is your boundary layer will get stripped out so that you will have more heat transfer. So vortices will form over the surface, so you will have more heat transfer.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So thank you guys. Thank you for your patience. And tomorrow at what time we'll have Ganesh will decide and let me know. Ganesh, are you there? Okay. So you want to decide? Fine. But tomorrow we'll have a class so that we'll finish it off. At least one particular topic we'll try to finish. Heat exchangers, radiation is there, boiling and condensation you still want to have. So I think with May we may not be able to finish, and I think that in June also we can continue the classes. I hope so, because you have exams in July. So let's have these sessions. I mean, if you are finding it useful, better we'll go. And if you don't find it, then we'll see. When MPTL classes are there, it's up to you. Whether if you want me to continue, I'll do that. Okay. So it's all based on the majority of the students. So what was the class presentation present today? 20 people, 25 around? Okay.
35.
Right. So how you people are doing out, staying at homes only? Are you coming out or? Right. Okay, guys. Take care. Take care. We'll meet tomorrow. Yeah.